50 years, Bloody Sunday, the march through Selma. What does all that mean to us today? We're going to take a look at it and have a very special guest. Be sure you stay tuned. I'm Larry Rice, and this is Here's Help. Bloody Sunday, the day in which we just saw the anger of the white folks just coming down upon African Americans that wanted to vote. I have with me a special guest, and we're going to be talking about that Bloody Sunday and the change that's come about and the change needed today. Tell everyone your name.
My name is Anthony Shahid.
And Anthony, I'm glad you could join me. There are a lot of stuff going on in Selma on this 50th anniversary in there.
Yeah. I just came back, but I always start off with the name of Allah, the most gracious, okay, the most merciful, and I bear witness in all the prophets from Abraham to Muhammad. I'm honored to come on your show, and thank you for inviting me.
God bless you, brother.
God bless you, too. It's deep that you just talked about. I just got back.
Mm-hmm.
I was down there 2 days.
Okay.
And it's very deep what's happening, but really nothing has changed in America, but it's 50 years ago, they were actually going through what you see us going through here in St. Louis, Ferguson, and the whole WAP. And right now, it ties into they couldn't vote, but you can't keep homeless people. I'm not being smart with you, but you can't even keep homeless people in your shelter. So it all ties into what's happening in Selma, and it brings our people more conscious. Hopefully this movie, which really is what happened, when you look at Ferguson, is really at the end of the movie, too, if you get a chance to see it, they talk about Ferguson. It ties into all of that. But I want to cover that, too, but I'm really concerned about the homeless, because to me, homeless life matter, because all of us can be in this condition. So you just ask me the questions, and I'm ready to fire away. You can ask me anything you want to ask.
Well, the thing is that I don't know if people are able to make the connections between Selma 50 years ago, Ferguson today, and how they're trying to stop us from sheltering people that are homeless.
Well, you got Bull Connors during that time. You had a guy named Jim Clark. You had a guy named Governor Wallace. In this day and time, you got a guy named Francis Slate. These are the same players. I mean, just the names have changed, but the faces has changed, but the names, you know, they synonymous. You got Bob McCullough. You got Stinger. They're the same folks. You got Selma, and you got Clayton. You got Ferguson. You know, anytime you take the position of not being concerned about homeless people, you're more concerned about your business people and what the business people up and down Washington is going to think about having homeless people. I think I talked to you once before about, I'm not sure if it was the Final Four, if it was the World Series, but I remember real good how they wanted to relocate them because they didn't want the world news seeing homeless people laying out during that time. So what they did during that time, they was able to move them to wherever they moved them. I'm not sure where they moved them to, but I know they moved them. And time that Final Four was gone, by the time the World Series gone, I think they had 2 World Series here. They moved them so the people didn't see it, the world didn't see it, then they moved them back. But now, the mere fact that they're talking about closing down your shelter, and it's only because you won't play ball with them. You know, I guess you didn't never play baseball or something, because by now you suppose it's the Cardinals city, and you should know how to play ball now. I think you're on their list. Well, I take that back, I know you're on their list. So it ties into Selma. It ties into 50 years ago, because what happened 50 years ago is still happening now. The mere fact they're attacking you, it proves that they don't care anything about people unless these people have some type of what they call influence. But that wasn't the work of Jesus or Prophet Muhammad or none of the other prophets. They were concerned about the man who was in the street.
And there are a lot of things that are taking place and a lot of events, and we want to fill you in on some of them. For example, you got a lot of things going on in Selma. You're going to be gathering together over 100,000 people. Yeah. And I also want to mention there's a dear, wonderful lady, Melissa Davenport, that's actually putting a bus together to go down there. If you guys and gals would love to be a part of that, give her a call, 314-835-7157. That's 835-7157, and she'll tell you the arrangements that are being made to have a bus go there, because there are bus loads of people coming in. A lot of stuff taking place over that weekend of March 7th and 8th in there.
Well, I would like to get this young lady's number, too, because what we're doing is taking 50. When I went down to Selma, and I have a little piece here on it. And when I went down to Selma, they're asking us to bring some young people from the Ferguson, St. Louis area, and they want us to at least bring 50 of them down there. And they want us to be the center of attention because of what has happened Ferguson and St. Louis is one of the same now. 50 years ago, nothing has changed. Bob McCullough and them, what they done did in this era, they haven't met not one demand, and they're getting cockier. They're getting worse. Mm-hmm. St. Louis City Police with Sam Dotson and them, they're getting worse. They've made, in the last 1 year, they've made five lieutenants. They've replaced five black lieutenants with five white ones. Six white shirts, meaning major, captain, and four lieutenants, past the five lieutenants since Michael Brown has been assassinated. I believe they've did at least about another 10 or 15 white sergeants since Michael Brown has been killed, and maybe one or two blacks. So nothing has changed. As a matter of fact, it's worse. So all this is really tying into it.
We mentioned Selma, and then on March the 12th, we plan to move in front of St. Louis City Hall for a sleep-in on March the 12th. And if you can participate in that, please call us at 881-3218. That's March 12th, and that's 30 days before April 12th, when they want us to start showing how we're reducing to 32 people. And if we don't, they don't want us to have anybody in here on May 12th. So it's really bad news when you start looking at how they really came down with this vote. But if you want to help, that's 881-3218. And then, Anthony, here, you're gathering a lot of folks that are going to be coming here in March.
Can I tie it into what you're doing? Well, what's deep about what you just said is we'll be just getting back from this national march. Mm-hmm. Selma is expecting over 100,000 people. Mm. Matter of fact, on the 7th, which is the Saturday, Sunday's Bloody Sunday, but Saturday, Barack Obama, the President of the United States, along with about 30 congressmen are coming in there. So this is a big piece here. Mm. But you're saying the 12th, what we want to do, we want to talk about Reverend Wright and what you're doing at 11, help me with the address here.
It's at 1411 Locust.
1411 Locust.
Right.
We want to be talking about that because 2 days after we get back here, I think on the 9th or the 10th. Uh-huh. So, you know, I'm going to be out there with you, and we're going to use all this national attention that we're bringing here because we're going to do a national march here on the 20th of March and the 21st of March. The 20th, we're going to be in Clayton. Mm-hmm. Good old Clayton with Bob McClan. That's my opinion of him. His name is McClan, Bob McClan. We're going to visit old Bob McClan out there in Clayton. And then we're going to be in Ferguson, but we're bringing on the 21st. So on the 20th, we'll be in Clayton. The 21st, we'll be in Ferguson. And then I got a surprise for you dealing with the homeless on the 22nd.
Yeah.
So we got some nice surprise for them. So, you know, a whole lot of people want to sleep out. We want to get a chance to, Francis, I'm inviting him to come on out and sleep out here with us too.
to get a taste of what it's really like being out there among the people.
So that's 2 days after you saying the 12th. We're going to be out there with you. And I promise you, from day one that we were going to work together. And I like working with you, and I'm going to work with you. I gave you a commitment. When I give you my word on something, I keep my word. My word is good.
On Dr. King's birthday, y'all were part of March, and you helped bring the folks by 1411 Locust and had some great marches. One in particular, when you guys were out there at Market and 15th, they went something like, they think it's a game, they think it's a joke, it's not a parade, the system is broke. I want you to show you that chant just for a few minutes. As they were declaring, they think it's a game, they think it's a joke, it's not a parade, the system is broke. Would you like to expound on that?
Well, it's self-explanatory. They think they haven't taken serious what's happening with the black lives and that black lives matter. Mm-hmm. They're not taking it serious that homeless life matter. What just happened on, was that January the 19th when we left from down in front of the old courthouse and we marched down at least 400 or 500 people decided to come down here with you, because we thought what was more important was homeless life, because we thought if Dr. King was here at this day and time, if Prophet Jesus was here in this day and time, Prophet Muhammad was here in this day and time, they would have been here feeding the homeless, worried about the poor, clothing them, bringing food to them, not just going through another ritual. It's time out for ritualism. So we thought it was more important to come here to support you and what you're doing, and not just you, homeless people, period. You represent them. And you're standing up and doing really the work of the real work of Jesus. People talk about Jesus, but you know, everybody didn't like Jesus, so you kind of a lot of like him right now, because from my understanding, they don't like you that much.
They considered him a nuisance, like they consider what we're trying to do here. Yeah. But I thank God, because you were out there right also in front of 1411 Locust, and they were chanting, "Homeless Lives Matter." Homeless Lives Matter. You took that with you over to the Board of Public Service that day when they came out with that racist decision, that all-white board. They one African-American sat there. They wouldn't let him vote. But each one of them came along and declared it a nuisance that we were sheltering the homeless in this area. I mean, something's wrong with all that.
All of them were spokesmen for Francis Slay. Mm-hmm. That was done under the direction of Francis Slay. I'm willing to bet you, and I can't prove it, but I'm 99% sure that he picked up that phone and made a call letting them know, this is exactly what I want done. Because if they thought the mayor had a problem with something, that would have never happened. This was something that he co-signed for. And don't leave that little mice out, Rankford, the chief of staff. Don't leave that little mice out there. He's trying to leave out with that billionaire Rex, whatever his name
Sandfield.
Is. Sandfield. Yeah. But before he leave, I want to make sure we get that mice too. You know, because you better believe that if Rankford had a problem with it, you better believe if Slay had a problem with it, they wouldn't have done it.
Well, his chief legal counselor for the city of St. Louis in January resigned from the city and went to work for the legal firm of the people that were trying to get us to declare it a nuisance. So you talk about conflict of interest in that. They didn't see any conflict in that. And they went right along and just voted. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, just right on down the line. But again, if you have a city that's 48% African-American, 42% Caucasian, and it took him 14 years to put one African-American to head of a department that ended up on that Board of Public Service. He couldn't vote. You don't have a representation. You have a plantation.
Well, it's the same as Selma. So you keep on saying, how do it match up? Mm-hmm. You just said it. This is the same thing that they did in this day and time. You know, you got somebody there, and it's really like a smoke and mirror. They're there, they're present, but they're absent at the same time because you don't give them a chance to speak out or say anything. And then if they do, it don't make any difference. If we voting and it's seven people and you one person, it don't make no difference what you say anyway. Mm. Whatever you say don't change a thing, because when we take it to a vote, guess who lose?
Yeah.
You know, so if you don't have none but out of I think it was seven positions there. And you only got one black there? But it just showed you in this day and time how they feel they can do. I keep on talking about the chief of police, and I had a hell of a good relationship with him at first. But when I started seeing how one time they had 15 sergeants that they made, and all of them were white, every last one of them, and then they had four lieutenants and was two blacks and two whites, I would say, well, at least you would have made all four lieutenants black. But after then, in the last, I'll say 32 sergeants, and I stand to be corrected, but I know what I'm talking about, but I stand to be corrected. Out of the last 32 sergeants, 28 of them are white. So, and out of the out of 17 positions of lieutenants, is only one that's black. So what it shows you is that these guys here are worse. At least during that time, I knew they didn't like me. Bull Connors never gave me the impression he liked me, period. Yeah. But these guys give the impression that they're real human beings, which that's my opinion. I don't believe they are. I don't believe they have a soul the way they tell about putting homeless people out. When I seen that, that's what made me stand up and say homeless life matters. But when you can stand up and you can come with that kind of force with no blacks there and think nothing about it, you don't have a conscience about it. And think nothing about it. And I have to keep talking about the homeless because I know you want to talk about Selma, but I want to talk about Selma too, but I want to talk about people are homeless. That means, you know, you was talking about sleep deprivation. How do you pronounce
it? Sleep deprivation.
Right. They're talking about how they were doing that waterboarding and things and all the criminal activities they were doing. This is the same thing. And I heard you talk about that, and I had to focus in on what you were saying. It's the same thing. If I can't go to sleep because I'm cold, or if I'm trying to go to sleep but I'm too cold, and I keep waking up, and then somebody tapped me under my feet and say, hey, move on. You got to go somewhere. I'm sleepy all the time. That's torture. That's real torture, not to have a place to sleep. That's torture, not to have food. So I always take it back to a human rights violation. Yes. Malcolm said something during those times, because he also spoke in Selma. Mm-hmm. He said, quit calling this a civil rights problem and call it a human rights problem. Human rights is the first thing. You should treat me first like a human being when I walk in here. Mm-hmm. Civil thing is the second thing you do. Then treat me like a civil person. But the first thing, they're not treating people like human beings when you don't want to even offer them shelter. A man on death row, you can't have him sleeping out on the street till you kill him, and you know you're going to kill him. You got to at least give him a place to stay. These people don't want to put nothing in place to an overnight shelter all night long, and they had a problem with you for what you're doing. They told you, don't worry about 300 people. 32 is your limit.
And if you don't do that in April, they want to take it down to zero in May. And, you know, we see the tragedy of Michael Brown. They kill him and they leave his body out there for 4.5 hours. Now they leave live human beings not only 4.5 hours all night long in the dead of winter, but as he indicated, night after night, you go into these downtown parks that says no one in after 10 o'clock at night. And they sleep there. They move them on. They say, where do we go? They used to tell them to come down to New Life, but now they're trying to stop the last place they got. Yeah. It is torture.
You know, the night that we slept outside, and I can't think of the exact night.
It was Christmas Eve, December 24th.
Christmas Eve. It was some people actually telling real stories.
Oh, yeah.
And maybe, you know, you'll show another clip of that, or you got some other clips here.
Oh, I got stories that we could tell you. I mean, and, you know, you're going down to Selma. I have to tell you about the woman that was in Mobile that was sleeping in the house, and the police came on, pulled guns on her. Then they arrested her, put her in jail for 3 days. She got out. She slept in a cemetery for 2.5 weeks, then got on a bus, ended up at the bus station here, and they ended up sending her down here. I mean, we're getting people that are really hurting. People that are sleeping in these little Home Depot huts that they have, they come to us here. People that can sit by hospitals day after day after day. And people are going to die out there.
Well, what we're going to do is everybody should get a chance to see. So I'm asking and I'm putting a public call out to everybody who honors the sound of Brother Shaheed Forces. You know, I've been working in this city for over 30 years, and God has blessed me to help a lot of people. Any of you are looking at me right now, you know, Brother Shaheed is real serious. March the 12th at 4 o'clock, I need you to be out here with me. I need you to be out here with Reverend Rice. I need you to be out here with the homeless, because you need to just get an idea of what it's like to be out there for an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours. And the thing about us, on the 12th, you at least know on the 13th you can go back home.
Yeah.
See, that's what you can do, the ones in the television listening audience.
Yeah.
But the ones that are here, that live here, can't do that.
That's right. And people are hurting. And I thank God for those that are speaking out, like Maxine Johnson.
Right now, this is what we are doing. 90% of the people are black folks look like me. We need to keep this building open. They use a bogus law or the nuisance law. Many black people are losing their homes. I believe God allowed Pastor Rice to get on the scene, not just to save Larry Rice, but to be a voice for black people that's losing their homes. They got a bogus court system. If somebody breaking your house, raping your child, you call the police three times, they take your house. So we're fighting against a system to keep this building open, to partner with other churches and other people like you and I. I wish I had a chance to talk to the young lady that was talking. Right now, they're using this system to shut down your brother, your cousin, your uncle. They don't have an answer. They got a bogus number, 211, 411, just to distract you. They got a lie saying he got $50 million because that man walked this building. Well, you know, if you tell a lie long enough, you'll believe a lie. This building must stay open for our men, our women, our children. You at home in your warm bed making a scene in the audience while they don't even have somebody to sleep. The women are being raped and beaten in the streets. This is a safe haven. That's you right. Want to do something? Don't talk. Shut your mouth up and get involved. I don't want to hear no talking. I want some action. Call the city hall tomorrow. Dial that number. Ask for the mayor's number. The answer, hang up. Call again, hang up. Call again, hang up. You want to mess up his world. Call your senators. Call your governors. And get that bogus system removed from the city hall to the regular court system. Power only concedes the power. In order for wicked people to prevail, for us to do nothing but complain in the audience. I don't even know what I'm talking.
That's right.
I want some action. Sign the petition. The petition's going around.
Yes.
Sign that petition.
I thank God for those that are speaking up and speaking out at this time are not tolerating the people, the rich folks trying to put the homeless out on the streets. Jesus told the story of Lazarus and the rich man. They're trying to take away Lazarus' crumb, the last major place they can walk in, trying to stop us from sheltering the homeless. Something is wrong with all that. And to help people really see it in perspective, many folks are going and being a part of this historical march in Selma, Alabama.
What I like us to do is because we're taking 50 youth mm-hmm. to Selma. And anybody who would like to join, you know, they can touch bases with you. We're going to give you all the information because I want to tie into you because we don't want to be like we're separate. Whatever we're doing, we're going to be pushing this homeless piece down there. This is going to be a national agenda. This is going to be on our agenda because it's not just here in St. Louis. We know we're going to keep it focused here because especially when they come here on the 20th and the 21st of March. But down there, they're homeless all over. But we want to make this issue because Ferguson, they have literally told us that when we come from St. Louis / Ferguson, that really the center of attention. You know what they said to me? They said, this is just as big as the announcement of Barack Obama coming, that we're going to bring 50 youth, and we're coming as the delegation, myself, Brother Zaki Baruti, and also Mike Brown Sr.
Yes.
His family is going. He's going to be a part of that. And they say this is just as big when they make an announcement that we're coming from Ferguson. I didn't really understand that we had made that much impact around the globe, but I guess we have. And what we want to do is tie it into all the national spotlight is on us. We want to make sure that they can call Mayor Slate.
That's right.
I think that number is 622-3201. Is it okay if I get his number?
You definitely give it out.
I think I already gave it out, though, before
Let's
I got your
ahead.
Permission.
That's right.
622-3201. We're going to ask people from around the country to call Slate.
Yes.
And ask him to rethink what he's going to do because the world is looking at him. But then again, he might be like Bob McClan and don't care about the world looking at him because as long as he got a place to live, it's okay. But they want us to come. And then in turn, what they're going to do on all their literature and information, they're going to give us all the national attention that we need for March the 20th in Clayton and March the 21st in Ferguson.
Right.
And also the surprise I got for you for the 22nd.
I got a
real good surprise for you.
Oh, that'd be great. We'll love to have people come on aboard.
It's going to be guests who come to dinner, but it won't be Cindy 48.
And March 12th, I want to mention to people, because we've had the National Coalition contact us about March 12th, too. So we'll try to bring in on the March National Coalition on all this stuff. And a lot of things happening, brothers and sisters. Let's stand together. If we don't stand together, we're going to fall one by one. That's what they love to do with the homeless out there, is knock them off one by one by one. Earlier, was talking about sleep deprivation, the torture, and people wake up in the middle of the night, and if they dare to lash out, I mean, lash out at the police, they'll lock them up if they don't shoot them. Rich woman like Zaza Gamora years ago slapped a police officer, got 3 days. If a young African-American slaps a police officer, they'll shoot him.
They're going to get shot and think nothing about it. But I want to publicly thank you. I've did it before, and I'm doing it now for what you're doing, working with homeless, because everybody has to have a calling. Some people's calling is working with elderly. Sometimes you got people who work with people who are deformed, have other, you know, issues. And yours is working with people who are less fortunate. And you can really see that you're serious about it. You know, I feel you. I don't just deal with people just to deal with them. So when somebody see me on this show with you, because that's what they told me a whole lot. I said, Brother Shaheed, that caught us off guard. You was with Reverend Rice. I said, well, that means that he had got to be okay. Because I ain't co-signing for nobody that ain't okay. You know, if you're about our people, and you're about the work of the people, and that's the work of Jesus. You're doing the work of Jesus, and I'm doing the work of Prophet Muhammad, and it's time for them to come together, because through Abraham, he had a son, Ishmael, and he had a son named Isaac or Ishak, and both of them was from them. So it's time for us to come together and bridge that gap.
Well, when you see like the brother over here behind the camera, and you see the people in the lobby, and you see all these people really working to get their lives together, like family. And then these evil forces.
Dockett's son. I just met Richard
Dockett's
son. Yes, Richard,
and he's working with us. And here's these evil forces that just out of wickedness that want to try to tell us to put them all back out on the street where they came from. We're not going to do that. We can't do that. We got to stand together. If they want to lock us up, they have to lock us up because we got to have to stand up in behalf of these people that have nowhere to go.
Hey, we got locked up
about three or four months together.
And guess what? I can promise you that day that you get locked up, I bet you I'll be right there with you. And I don't bet, so I'm going to take that word back. But you got my word. When you get locked up, I'm going to lock up.
Well, we've got to do something. And again, we're fighting this in the federal courts. And thank God for the activists that are coming forth at this time. I mean, we're even working to build a shelter in Illinois so that they can't say the Illinois people are coming to St. Louis. We've got to put a place in Illinois for the Illinois people. But I'm telling you, these are St. Louis people. These are people from throughout Missouri that aren't getting help while the governor and the politicians are deciding where they're going to build a football stadium for a billionaire so millionaires can watch more millionaires play. And they don't even discuss a place for the homeless, and they want to destroy the last place that people have to come to.
Well, it's ungodly, immoral. You keep doing what you're doing, but the activists can do a few things, especially Brother Shaheed and Brother Zaki and a few of us. We can do some things you don't need to be doing. So once you do, you keep to what you're doing.
Well, I thank God for what you guys are doing out there.
And what we're going to do.
Standing steadfast.
And I don't usually call you that there. Hey, boy, you got a problem on your hand. I promise you. You got a problem on your hands. What you're doing with homeless people. And the way you're attacking this man for no other reason that he don't want to become your yo-yo, you got to answer for that on this earth, and you got to answer for it in the next life. But on the 12th, you got to meet us, okay?
Yeah, I'll be under his window out there. And again, I want you folks praying for us at this particular time. And you need to pray for this city, because I believe there's some judgment falling on this city because of the way it's treating the poor people. You know, and it's not going to be solved by hiring 160 more police officers. You can put a police officer on every corner, but it's not going to lift God's hand of judgment when they start mistreating the poor that they were doing it.
And they should do that, trying to help you get your center together. They should be trying to help do that on jobs. It's a whole lot of education. It's a whole lot of areas they could sit and put that money in. And when they get through talking, it's not going to be a lot of black police anyway. But again, I know our time is running. I want to thank you. We're going to work with you on the 12th. We're going to be here. As soon as we get back from Selma, I'm bringing some people back here from Selma. So we got some national attention that's coming in here. And we're going to have some national people out there laying down there with you. So I want this young man to know this slicker than fish grease, because he gave the impression that he liked black folks, but Francis Slade do not like black folks. You can see it from that board up there. But anyway, we're going to bring some people to help you get you some attention on what he's doing.
Well, thank you, and God bless you, brother.
God bless you. Thank you. Keep it up. Thank you too.
And we ask all of you to stand with us at this particular time, because again, we believe that, you know, we've got to be out here with these folks because they have no other place to go. And God is calling forth his people at this time.
Your brother's keeper.
Yes. And are you going to be a part of that at this time? Let me know. Join us. If you want more information about the trip to Selma, we've got information on that. If you want to know more about on the 12th, call us at 314-881-3218.
On the 20th and the 21st.
And the 20th and 21st of March. A big thing's going to be taking place.
50,000 people.
He says coming in on that day. So again, 314-881-3218. 314-881-3218 or 421-3020. Thank you for caring and sharing, and may God bless you in a very special way as you reach out to the hurting and the homeless.